Hello and welcome. My name is Sanjay Soni. Here is a micro-learning readiness video about Azure SQL Data Warehouse. Thank you for taking the time to join us. Now, let's get started. Hi, Ron. How are you doing today?
Doing fantastic, Sanjay. Great to see you again.
Great to see you as well. So what do you do at Microsoft?
I'm a senior program manager here at Microsoft on the Azure SQL Data Warehouse team.
All right, so let's get started. So we're going to talk about managing mixed data warehousing workloads today. Now, SQL Data Warehouse provides some rich and new capabilities in this space. And before we jump into those scenarios where, you know, workload management benefits solutions, can you please cover some of the basic concepts?
Sure, absolutely. So let's take a look. On your Azure SQL Data Warehousing system today, demand's coming in from all different directions. You've got Azure Databricks data loads happening, Azure Data Factory, orchestration loads happening. Once you get that data on your Azure SQL Data Warehouse, you've got the ELT transformations, building your facts and dimensions, maintaining your data vault, pushing data out to Azure Data Lake, consuming data, pulling data in from the data lake. Then you've got your entire reporting layer off to the right-hand side here of the diagram. Power BI, reporting layer, pulling in offline PowerBook refreshes, ad hoc doing whatever ad hoc does, right? Lots of crazy workloads. Azure Analysis Services cubes, pulling in cube refresh data, and then custom apps. It's coming from all directions.
Yes.
And there's tons of mixed workload demand coming into the Azure SQL Data Warehouse. So what we've done inside of Azure SQL Data Warehouse is started delivering some of these enhanced workload management capabilities, and we're going to start off with delivering workload importance to begin. So when you think about the workload management lifecycle, think of it almost as this process of monitoring, analyzing, and configuring. And there's really, at the core, there's a couple of different schools of thought. So you can size for the peak. I can size my infrastructure. This happens a lot with on-prem workloads where you size for the Black Friday event.
Yes, of
course. Or your fiscal year close for your financial systems where you size and you have all this hardware laying around. As people have matured their solutions and moved into the cloud, we've got now more of this kind of auto scale or elasticity happening, and we see that even today with Azure SQL Data Warehouse, where folks will slide up the slider bar in the portal and start bringing more compute online. Or even I like to call it the auto spend model, where they're just spending, you know, scaling up, spending more, and then scaling down to try to save some money from time to time. But this isn't really efficiently using the hardware that you have at your disposal. So this workload management idea, this lifecycle approach here where you monitor, understand your workload, understand where your spiky activities are, and then you analyze that, classify it, put data into groups, understand SLAs, and then you go ahead and configure the system so that you actually are able to meet your SLAs and deliver the business value. So if we take a look, just a click down now into the workload management concepts, basically, the first concept that you want to think about is classification. And classification at its core set is basically load and queries, yeah. Right? So folks, data warehouses don't live on an island. You're going to load some data in, you're going to query some data. Mm-hmm. So this idea of classification is mapping requests, mapping workloads, understanding, you know, putting a bow around and understanding what your workload looks like in terms of load and query, and then assigning some resources and also assigning some priority or some importance to that. So some other ideas or some other types of classification include ETL or reports and ad hoc. You can even think about classifying and putting importance on different types of data sources that you're loading into your warehouse. So maybe I have some sales data. It's very critical that that data gets loaded. I'm going to stamp that with a high importance. Maybe my marketing data, my clickstream data, my weather data, my social feeds, those are of lesser importance. So I put them with lower importance. So that comes to the last concept here on the slide. And that's what we're delivering here with the first version of workload management, and that's importance. So importance is all about influencing access to the resources. And by resources, we mean CPU, I/O, memory, but we also mean locks. So locks can become very important when you have this conflicting scenario of readers and writers going after the same data.
Yes.
I'm trying to maintain fresh data, but I'm also trying to have tight SLAs on my reporting side as well. But at the end of the day, what you want to have happen with importance is that the high business value work wins out overall.
Yep.
So establishing what is truly highly important to your workload, how you want to try to hit your SLAs, and then associating the necessary importance on top of that.
That was great. So what is available today in Azure SQL Data Warehouse?
Yeah, so today in Azure SQL Data Warehouse, we really have a pretty basic sort of resource management capability today within SQL Data Warehouse. And that comes in basically two forms. We have the resource classes that we have today, the dynamic resource classes, small, medium, large, extra large. And then we also have static resource classes. So that's all about assigning resources to requests. And the basic classification mechanism we have today is just SP add role member of assigning in user logins to an actual resource grant. So that's existing capabilities that we have today.
Great. So how does this change with the new enhanced workload management capabilities in Azure SQL Data Warehouse?
It's a great question, Sanjay. So we're going to introduce a new classification syntax, and it's going to give you a richer capability to classify your workloads. Here is an example of what that syntax is going to look like. So you'll have a create workload classifier syntax. You'll be able to specify a classifier name. Today, for now, you'll be able to assign workload groups equal to existing resource classes. And then here's where the new capabilities start to come into play. You can now establish importance on top of your classification. So we have five options here: low, below normal, normal, which is the default, above normal, and high. Then we also have the ability, again, to map things into a security account or via the member name parameter. Here's an example, kind of classic example where you have assigning of your CEO, right? So here's the Satya username being assigned into the high importance classifier. So any requests now that come in from the CEO will have the static RC20 resource grant associated with it and the high importance stamped on those requests.
That was great information. Thank you so much, Ron, for being here with us today.
You bet, Sanjay, my pleasure.
Thank you for watching this video. Learn more about this and other topics at azure.com/SQLDW.